Hey guys, so Freddie Washington, Nathan East,
Steve Verone,
incredible.
So I thought, you know, I've done the clinic a few times, and Chris has been nice enough to ask me to come. And just kind of talk to you guys, play a little bit, and have done a few different configurations. And I'm so happy that, first of all, that my all-time hero, Steve Verone, was here. And like, so this is like a kind of surreal dream for me. Like, I don't know, it's like bass player dream, you know, like. I thought, you know, I'm in contact with both these guys a lot. And really, it's like the reason I play, and it's sometimes it's hard because sometimes I listen, I play, and I sound like when I hear Nathan play or Freddie play, like when I'm playing, sometimes I think like, I sound like I'm trying to play like Nathan. It's me playing like Nathan, but not really though. But what it is his all of his influence on me, all of Freddie's influence, and the same thing with James Jameson and Jerry. Where's Jerry? Is Jerry here? Yeah, there he is. Right. So you know. And the bottom line is that for all of us, no matter what we do, and especially those of you who are bass players or engineers or musicians, like we stand on the shoulders of giants. I mean, absolutely. This is kind of why and how this all became possible. I mean, there was no Jerry and no Jameson and no Jaco and go back to Paul Chambers and even before that, you know, Milt Hinton. I mean, you know, there is no us. So this, for me, is to talk about beyond the bass. You know, because I mean, we think about work and how do I get work and what things do I need to do to prepare myself for the job. So, the playing is that Miles Davis said that the note is the note. You know, a C is a C, and that's 20% of it. 80% of it, 80%. Close your eyes, young fella. Close your ears. There you go. 80% is the motherfucker who's playing the note, and that's. What's important? It's the guy who's playing. The girl who's playing the note and really putting the love and putting their heart on it. So some of you may not know some of these stories, so I'll share some and then we'll kind of talk a little bit. So I was 19 years old and living in Watts in the projects. And I found that they were doing this workshop for it was called Wickham. Workshop for inner city aspiring musicians. And it was at Locke High School. And I went there, you know, and trying to learn how to play, and they had a big band. And they had a guest speaker, and it was Freddie Washington. And he had just moved to town, and he was playing with Patrice Rushen and Herbie Hancock and all that. So I met him, we talked, we became friends, and our friendship blossomed from there. And there's a lot of story in between that. But that's my introduction to Freddie Washington. And that same year, I met Ndugu, and Ndugu said, you sound good, you can read. He said, you need to meet this young cat just moved from San Diego, Nathan East, and get, you know, I'm gonna give you his number, call him and take a lesson. So I called Nathan, and I saved up my money, because it was, you know, wasn't like that. So it was Coke bottles. I mean, I was really like, you know, I called him, and then, you know, and he said how much it was, and I waited till I got the money. You know, dollar here, dollar there. And I called him. I went over to his apartment or house, back house in Burbank, because keeping it real, he was coming out here setting it up. It wasn't, again, it wasn't like that. He wasn't Nathan East. No. Yeah. But I took the lesson from Nathan. We played some tunes. We did some reading. He said, whatever you're doing, keep doing it and keep your money. So, I mean, I came, I left richer in my pocket and in my knowledge. So I had a double whammy that day, you know. And then later on, Nathan called me to kind of start subbing for him on different gigs and stuff and rehearsal bands, or if he could not make a rehearsal. And I called both those guys up, and I would sit in the studio right behind them like a fly on the wall. I was scared to even blink. I was like I'm gonna miss something, you know. So anyway, I mean, that's my, you know, the guys kind of really got behind me and pushed me forward and said, hey, you can do it. So
there it is.
That's why I'm here.
And now, I'm calling Rickey for lessons right now.
Me too.
Yeah. So I want to talk about, why don't you guys, I'll give it to both Freddie and Nathan about beyond the bass. What does it take to push beyond this so that you can just base the basics, provide for yourself and go out and play music, this thing that we all love so much. Freddie?
Okay, beyond the bass, put it there. Now, beyond this instrument, I look at it like this. If you didn't have this instrument in your hand, my thing is all about feeling. A person's only gonna know you, the guys that you don't know who's on the records that I used to listen to, that's beyond the bass. You only know what you feel. And when they play, and I didn't know it was a Jerry DeMont, I didn't know it was a Chuck Rainey or James Jamerson, I just know what I felt. Mm-hmm. Now, when you show up to any situation and you play, you have to leave something. You have to leave a feeling, something that people can connect to, and that's what we've done all these years for, you know, we've done all these records, this and that, and people, they keep going back to these records because they felt something. Now, I come from the adage, if I was to take this bass out of my hand, for the guys who play bass, there's a lot of great bass players here. I see one in the front row right here. Okay. If you didn't have this bass in your hand, what does your body language, I'm all about body language, what does your body language tell you what to do? How do you move? When you're trying to get people to dance, you have to have some kind of sense of rhythm in your body. And that's what I play off of, is rhythm in my body. I don't play bass no more. I know how to play the bass. I play bass feel. So it's all about the feel of the instrument to take you to another place. And they say, man, did you hear that guy? I mean, it's not the notes he was playing. It's the feeling. I mean, did you hear that feeling that was coming out of him? I mean, it was just all over you. And that's what you need to go to the next level. You can read. Reading is one thing, this and that, but they're just notes. Then after that, what does it feel like? So that's where I come from, totally with the feel and the groove.
Right.
Yeah.
So Nate, guys, can you come in a little more? Because I think some people want to come in. They're trying to get in, or just let them by so they can get over to the other side. Great. Nate, I know, I mean, so not only are you a great bassist, but you're a composer. What other ways would you recommend for other people to try to find a way to make a living, you know, if they don't have their bass in the hand, if they don't have a gig? How do you make money and provide for yourself other than playing the bass?
Right. I mean, that's where I think all of us, we become entrepreneurs, and we're in trying to figure out ways to generate income, you know, whether it's songwriting. And I think those of us that have had opportunities here, we just happen to be in a session with, you know, somebody and say, hey, I got a song, or you know, here's the bass line to Forget Me Nots, and then all of a sudden it's so bad that you're the writer on the tune, or you came in with a tune, and then all of a sudden that tune is the becomes Men in Black's theme song. So what happens is, not only are you playing bass, but I think songwriting has been one of the things that has been an additional source of revenue for us, as well as producing. And so it's kind of like not just wearing one hat, but but taking advantage. And when you're in the moment, you say, hey, wait a second, I see an opportunity here, and I see you know, a chance to not only insert something else other than playing the bass, but just kind of try to improve on the situation that's there.
Great. I just want to, Steve, what do you look for when you're playing, you know, in a bass player or musician, period?
Does it work right?
Yeah.
You know, I said something once that that got me into a lot of trouble with Anthony Jackson. I did an interview, and somebody said to me, how can you tell a good bass player? And I said, well, you can't hear him.
Rim shot, please.
There's four guys in here now that when I play, I don't even know what they're doing. But when I listen back to it, I can feel them. If they're gone, it's like, where the hell did they go? You know, right. The amp cuts out or something. But the moment that I listen back to it, then I hear all this other stuff that they're doing. How a bass player, you know, I don't play any melodic instrument. The only thing I play is the drums. It's the only, if you know, I guess you can make that melodic, but I just play the drums. That's all I do. I took a piano lesson. I had somebody try and teach me how to play the piano once, like a little kid, you know? And the only thing I learned was that middle C is somewhere around the lock, you know? And it's a multiple choice, and I usually get it wrong. But I can hear, when I hear things, when I, because I, it doesn't stop me from writing music either. that doesn't, not being able to play, not being able, doesn't stop you from writing music. Except I write with Marcel, with Nathan's brother, and sometimes I come up with some notes, and Marcel looks at me like a dog that's hearing a dog whistle, you know, so like gets that look on his face, like what the hell is that? But you hear bass players that they play a note, and all of a sudden a regular chord will become massive, you know, will just become this really beautiful thing, and yeah, like you say, it's a note, but where do you play it? You know, I remember sitting next to Herbie Hancock once when he was jamming, and because I was playing like a Monday night jam band, and Herbie came in, and everybody wanted to play, so let somebody else play, and they were sitting. And I went over and sat next to Herbie, and he was sitting there, and he was just grooving. And all of a sudden, he went, bang! He hit this chord that just went so huge, you know, massively huge. And I said, "What was that?" And he said, "I got thousands of them." So these guys here, they got thousands of them. I'm just sitting here listening. You know, it's an honor to be asked by you guys, especially you guys, Jerry, come up here and stay here and play with you. For me, it's a drummer. Nice. They're the deal. Listen, whatever they got to say.
All right, we'll take one question, then we'll play a little more. Play talk. Question talk play. Any questions? Everybody's perfect. Okay.
Is that the Forgive Me Not space?
This is him.
All right.
Yeah.
Here, play a little bit of it, Freddie, for him. I have to let you know, I was playing that all wrong, and Freddie taught me every single note.
He got it right.
Yeah, no, but when I met him, because, you know, I'm like, what is that? Like, when I heard, I was like, and then with the song in F sharp, and then the bridge. Wait, that's a G, that's not an F, and I kept saying, is that an F sharp or is G? Am I losing my hearing already? What is happening?
Hey, beautiful.
That line scared me to death. I almost stopped playing when I heard that.
Tell us about Easy Lover, Nate. How did that happen?
You know, a similar thing of being in the moment. I was over there in London recording Philip Bailey's solo CD, and we finished the record basically. And one night he said, you know, we still don't have that undeniable single. You know, just like something that the record company could pick, really get behind. And literally just went over to the piano and started banging out the chords a little bit, and we got a little hook going, and then a verse, and we laid it down just 20 minutes to write, and we laid the track down that night and said, let's come back in the morning, listen to it, and make the record. And we listened to the record, and what we heard the next morning, that was the record,
right?
The demo, basically. So again, just kind of lucky to be in the right place at the right time.
Well, Freddie, why don't you play a groove, and then we'll just play something. We'll just have some fun and make some music.
Thank you.
I do a lot of mentoring and work with a lot of kids from, you know, I just left Stax Academy in Memphis working with the kids, and I work with Yola here. A lot of, I mean, that's really like my big passion, that part of it. But I do get letters from people saying, I wrote this song, and it starts there, and it continues on with, or I get a letter saying, I'm... how do I get in the band? And it's, I wrote this song, and I want to play in the band. And so I respond to every letter. And so I called the guy, and I said, well, what do you play? And he says, I play accordion. So I said, okay, well, you know, you play accordion. I said, well, why don't you learn how to play, you know, start learning piano? And you know, I'm corresponding with this guy, and he's emailing me, and we're calling. I said, play piano. So 6 months later, he says he, you know, plays at one of the hotels, and he plays accordion. He says, I've been working on my piano playing, but now I want to be a songwriter. I said, okay, well, then go ahead and work on that and study great singers with songs. And then he sent me a recording. And I said, you can email. It's an MP3 and email it. He says, I don't know how to do any of that. So he sent me a cassette. And on the cassette was a song he wrote called Alone and Crying. And it went like this. on the accordion. And I said, well, there's no lyrics. He says, yeah, but you can feel like alone. And I said, well, that's not alone and crying. Now, the point, so this it sounds like it's really like humorous. But the point is, so I got on the phone and I talked to him. And the point is that that's his reality. And my focus was to talk to him and get him to understand that his reality, although, means something to him, it's not marketable. And that's the real key behind it. I mean, you know, because that could be me. I mean, I could have this idea that what I have is amazing,
you know, and then, you know, ask your mother. It's like, that is so incredible. You know, so the deal is that we can't rely on our own understanding of what is good. And we can't rely on people who love us because, well, they think everything you do is good. So the key to that, and this is for everyone here as well, is that what you have is good. But is it your best? And so the best you is good enough. If you continue to strive to be the best you and learn and grow and be open to all the possibilities. But if you stay in a place where this is what I'm going to do and I'm great and not really have a real understanding of what it takes to be marketable and sell your music and to give the client what they want. These guys get calls because they want to hear what he does on that bass. I need that on my stuff. Same thing. I mean, all these guys. I mean, you know, and that's what they want. So you need to make sure that you have what it is that people want. And that's something, so to answer your question, I do get things like that. But and sometimes you look at it and you go, oh, well, he's crazy. He may be crazy now, but he may be able to turn that genius thing around. Right. Because there's something to being passionate about music and music, you know, saved my life. And I'm sure just listening to music can totally change your whole day. You know, you're having a really bad day and then you listen to some music or you put your instrument in your hand and it just falls off, you know, just falls off.
By the way, when I sent that, I was hoping you wouldn't share that story with everybody.
Well, see, and now here he is, Nathan East, songwriter, musician, piano player. You see, he went right to the piano and wrote that song.
I told you. Hoping you wouldn't tell everybody. That's right.
Yeah.
Forgive me if this was addressed earlier. I was a little late to the roundtable. Present company excluded, and you guys certainly all work with amazing drummers, but a bass player that taught me a long time ago once told me when I was very young that I'll never know how good a bassist I am until I play with a really good drummer. Because until I do, you'll be fighting the guy that's not so good and trying to hold it together. Clearly, with someone like Steve, that's not an issue. And you guys all work at the top level. I mean, you know, Freddie with Keith Carlock, et cetera. When in the past you've had a less than satisfactory rhythm section partner, or when you're even now working on something and struggling, how do you turn it around and how do you shift, you know, the musical conversation? Because sometimes you're stuck with what you have. And you can't get another guy, mm-hmm. but you've got to make it happen. Because everyone's looking at the tune, it's like, what's going on back there?
Nate. You go first.
Well, I just say call Steve Ferroni because then right. If you want to fix the problem immediately.
There's always a choice.
I can be hired as a hitman too.
So what do you do?
You know what? I feel very fortunate that I haven't really had to have that experience. I mean, because I've walked in every time I've walked in, it's been Steve Gadd. You know, I mean. There's Ferroni. I mean, we've spent so much time, JR, mm-hmm. and so I'm just blessed that I haven't really had that problem in a
long
time.
We don't get it a whole lot.
Yeah. So probably at this point, but I think early on, for me, everyone plays at a different time. But, I mean, Monk said just because you don't play drums doesn't mean you have to keep time. So everyone's responsible for keeping time. And sometimes, you know, in the past, I mean, I probably get it more than these guys because, like, at this point, I'm asked a lot to put together bands for different artists. So if I'm auditioning the musicians, drummers, and guitar players, I'm looking what Freddie said the first thing. I'm looking for it to make me feel something, and these guys have to connect. And it doesn't mean that this wasn't a good drummer. It just means that, like, I play with some drummers that play really on top. And I think I play in the middle, but then I play with drummers who play way behind. I mean, they're like another state. And I'm trying, and so it is work. I mean, I did have those experiences coming up that certain guys play, but now I know how to look for that. And if sometimes the job requires them to play way in the back. I mean, if you're gonna play some Gut Bucket Blues, I mean, that snare's gotta come right at the last possible minute before it's like not even in the same tempo. I mean, it's like way back. I mean, who was that? Steve, who played with Donnie Hathaway? Who played drums with that?
Oh,
No, drums.
Fred White.
Fred used to play way, that snare would come like, just right when you thought the next beat was coming. It's like, ah, right there. You know, so, oh, yeah. I mean, how do you play with, if I mean, you consider you play, where would you say you play mostly, would you say you play on top or in the middle?
No, I don't play on top. I try to be in the middle, not on top, not way too far back, because it's I play in waves. Like right. This. It's not on top, it's not in the middle. It's like right in the middle. So I want to always be in that sweet spot, right. Feel good place.
And what do you do if a drummer's playing on top? How do you just pull him back?
Yeah, I say get on my coattail and, you know.
Ride. What about you? What do you do? I mean, because different guys play, like right. So you just pull it back? I mean, how do you do that?
I try to constantly pull it back as well, just like just. You know, with your body language mm-hmm. and everything yeah. else, just kind of, mm-hmm. just kind, and you can feel the tug going, yeah. you know.
Yeah. And yeah, a lot of times with drummers, if they're like all over the place, the best thing you can do is be still,
or leave.
Yeah, that too. But
you don't want to go to jail for killing somebody.
Because he'll get confused if you're fighting. You have to be still. Kind of watch him, and sometimes I'll turn around to kind of see what his body's doing. And I said, okay, let me get inside. Let me try to get inside right. of him.
Okay, so yeah. So first recording session. Tell me first experience, and who was it with, and what was your experience?
Officially, there was a family in San Diego called the Patty Family Singers, and then of that group was Sandy Patty was the daughter, you know, and so I was 14 years old. That was the first session that I did, you know, and it was amazing because, you know, there's this tape and all this sounds awesome. But then actually the official record pop record was with Barry White, you know, and I came up here to L.A. and jumped on it.
And what song was that? Do you remember what the first song was?
We did, I remember it was this the record that had Ecstasy When You Lay Down right. Next to Me, you know.
And was that, did you do two bass parts?
There were two bass players in the room.
And who was the other bass player?
His name was Willie Seastrunk. I don't know where he is now, but
what was your part?
So, you know. Yeah, so one guy just did. That's all you did for the next 15 minutes. And then. You know, and I think I was on the low part.
Yeah.
You know. Cool. It was Freddie? Crazy.
Oh, man. Let me see. When I was 19 years old with Herbie Hancock, I think that was one of my first recording sessions. I did this record, Feet Don't Fail Me Now. And I played on the song, Feet Don't Fail Me Now. It was after we had went to the Circle Star Theater, played a gig that night, left the Circle Star. I was in a limousine. I was 19 years old. I'm like, is this how this work? Played with Herbie Hancock, jump in a limousine, go to San Francisco, cut a record. So we went in and cut Feet Don't Fail Me Now. So that was one of my first experiences, and it was a good one. Wow. And I can tell from that point up until now, it's changed. Because I was that little hungry bass player, and my influence is up in the, I'm from Oakland Bay Area, you know, Larry Graham was heavy at that time, and you had Paul Jackson from the Headhunters, so I was in all that. All that stuff. Wow. So it was another kind of energy then. Yeah. So that was great.
Yeah. Crazy.
All right. And my story is not so much like theirs. So I got a call. My first gig was Gladys Knight and the Pips, thanks to Nathan and Ndugu recommended me. And I was 19 as well. And so I met Ndugu and he called me for a recording session. Now, mind you, I had been playing since I was 14, but I'd never really been in a recording studio and never recorded before. So Paul Jackson Jr., I actually don't remember, it was because Nathan was busy, but that's probably why they called me. And I was trying to remember why I got the call, but so Ndugu was playing and they counted the song off. And we started playing, and Ndugu said, wait a minute. Bass player. Where's the fire, man? Where you going? You at the end of the song we just started. He said, yeah, relax, man, relax. Damn. So that was my first session.
Wow.
Damn.
Wow. Well, obviously, it didn't do too much damage to your career.
Oh, no, not at all.
Yeah. Well, you know, you have to go through those moments where you go, okay, just to, and then the engineer was Barney Perkins.
Oh man.
And so I'm playing, and now I'm really getting into it. And I'm really feeling it. But I'm playing, and I get to the note, and I'm so happy. It's a G, and I'm going, and the note's all wild because I'm. And I'm shaking it. I'm like, I'm doing it. He's like, hey man, you out of tune. Yeah, it's like, no, I'm playing the right note. You playing the wrong note. No, I'm playing the, you know. But you don't argue. Then you learn. Okay, shut your mouth. And then I looked, and I was like, oh, that's because I'm getting funky with myself. I'm getting funky. I'm making it funky. And I ended up playing out of tune. So I learned how to attack. Then I started going to sessions with these guys and watching. Like how they approach a note, how they get a note really recorded well, you know, because I mean, then you have so much to store. You hit the string at the wrong place, and it sounds horrible. It's like where do you place your hand? How do you mute notes? And
right.
So you have to just really work on. Any other questions before we're gonna play a little something? I guess, yes.
I see it's a blessing that you guys got this wonderful relationship, and I heard you mentor young people. How do you interpret that passion to a young student?
How do I interpret that passion to?
You have that passion, right. You have for the music to that young
my goal is to impart the passion for life, for yourself. The music is a byproduct of what we do. These guys and Steve and all of you guys play from a place that is from here.
Right.
And if you're not playing a place from here, then you need to find a way to get to here because it's inside out, not outside in. So I try to help them understand that who you are is how you play, who you are. And so confidence, you know, fearless, you have to have those traits in order to express yourself. It's art. Yes.
Rick, I have a question. I asked this question to Freddie last year about reading music. You know, like when you walk into a session and you have this long chart in front of you, and you have to read the notes, but you have to interpret it. And I was wondering how you approach that situation. How do you make it your own?
Right.
You want to answer that, Nathan?
Yeah, I think that's one of the things that we every day is a challenge for us, you know, to try to first of all honor the music that we're playing bass for. So I mean, I ain't trying to go in and really just like play everything I know, but first thing I do is listen, you know, and very carefully to what's going on, and then I just try to get a vision for what it calls for, you know, and that's my starting point. And then from there, I kind of start very simple. Until I hear what's going on lyrically or from the melody, and really just try to paint around that, you know. But
I'm talking about like when you're reading like note charts, like you have to go read a score, you
know. Note chart or
like if when if you're sight reading a chart and it's like a lot of notes on there, how do you make it sound good reading it the first time?
Oh,
is
I see.
Is that the question?
Yeah.
Exactly. Okay.
Pre-read.
Thanks. Well. I'll never forget. Yeah, you fake it. No, I'll never forget when I saw. I actually saw Freddie on a session once, and I asked him that same thing. He says, first thing I do is I go through and I look for the hardest lick, yep. The hardest
right.
passage in the chart.
Yeah, you look at the chart. You look at it, and then you kind of look down and see if what's the difficult if there's any difficult spots.
Right.
You just kind of suss it out, and then everything is going to pretty much you're going to flow into it. They're just notes. And it's your interpretation, it's your prowess, it's how you conceive the part to be played. The part is on the paper, but what you're gonna do to it ain't on the paper.
Right. Right.
You see what I'm saying? You have to come instinctual. Your prowess, your instincts of what everybody else is doing, you're listening. You're not really listening to yourself, you're kind of listening to what's going on around you, and you're just, like I say, playing bass feel. You're not playing bass.
You want it to sound like you wrote those notes.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And so to that end, like, so on the sessions I went to Nathan, he just let me kind of sit on the chair behind him and just watch. he would open the chart up and he'd make his notes and find the repeat signs, find out what the form of the song is, and the same thing. He would just look at it, you know, and I'm looking at him, looking at the chart, seeing what he's looking at, and realize that he's looking at a pattern. There may be something that would cause for a different fingering. My first film date, I'm in with an orchestra, and I'm scared. You know, it's 70 pieces, and the producer says, again, bass player. What are you playing? So I said, I'm playing what's on the chart. He says, don't play that. Play what it's supposed to be. That's that. Don't play that. You know, I just wrote something in there for you just so you'd have a guide, yeah. Thought. So I was intent. I mean, I've been working on my reading. I was intent. I was going to read every note exactly the same value. If it was... And whatever it was, but what he wanted was, he wanted me to do what would I do if I wrote it? That's what Nate was saying. Play it like you wrote it.
Yep,
like you wrote it.
But you always want to play what the arranger wrote.
Yeah,
to let him hear.
Play that first.
Play that first.
Don't start making it your own.
Until
too
he
soon.
Says abandon, and then you can go ahead.
Right.
He said abandon that.
Nate, but I'm gonna play something, man. You start something, and we'll jump in and follow you somewhere. Okay. All right. Nate Watts, what'd you say, man?
There he is.
I'm gonna be in the front row.
Give it up for Nate Watts. Nine. Come on.
That's the thing. Anybody knows anything about me? If I love Nate Denise and I love me some Freddie Washington and I have a nice amount of love for myself, but I will not listen to anything that Stevie Wonder plays unless Nate's playing, and that's God's honest
that's
truth.
Right. Come on. Man.
If I'm called to do anything with Stevie, I'm like, yeah, but and I it's okay. So I will be over there on the side. When that happens, and take my lesson. Brother Nate, love you, man.
All right.
Hey, save me that front row seat right there, my brother. Put my name on that seat for Nate's clinic. I want that one.
How we doing, Chris, on time? All right. Thank you.
All right, so we'll take a few more questions. Anybody have any questions about anything? Okay, great. Well, then we already know everything, so that takes care of that.
No one?
Cool. Yes, sir.
What's your recommendation for trying to get into the industry?
Diversity.
Don't know.
Yeah, I think make yourself valuable. Make yourself, all of our jobs it's the exact same job for all of us, is to add value. If you're not adding value to a situation, and I mean period, I mean your relationship, your family, your parents, your kids, your job is to add value. And I think that for you, getting in the business, how can you make yourself more valuable to whatever the music genre or style or work you're trying to do. So it's not enough to just take your instrument and shed and say, and I'm great, I'm the baddest bass player on the planet, you know, and you become that, and but all of that is in your garage and in your mind, because there's no such thing as the baddest anything. Right. So the goal is to learn what you can learn, learn more about songwriting, arranging, learn more about the technology and computers and dealing with Pro Tools and dealing with building music apps. I mean, you have to diversify so that you have multiple streams of income. And that will take care of everything, because when one style of music, like say if you're a jazz player, but there's no jazz work, then you're out of work. So if you play all the styles that, you know, if anyone saw Nathan earlier, I mean, he played upright, yep. Electric, five string, six string, 29 string, and you know, and true story, I Nathan was playing with Al Jarreau, and I saw the video, and he was playing synth bass, and so I got a call to go on tour with Whitney Houston, and they said, hey, you know, you play synth bass, and I said, yeah, and had never played. I mean, never played. I was like, yeah, and my thought was, if Nathan can do it, then I can do it in my mind, and I'm still working on it. So check back with me another 10.
You know, another thing is, like, if he knows Pro Tools, I know really good producers that the reason they got the job is because they knew how to work Pro Tools.
Yeah.
So that got him in the room. Next thing you know, the artist was so comfortable with them. Next thing you know, they're producing the record, you know.
Yeah.
And so that was the value that you're talking about, I think.
Exactly. I mean, and the same thing where it's like, if you know how to do that kind of work, and you get in and you're able to edit it and make them feel comfortable, because that's the other part of it. I mean, the knowledge is only 50%, but you need knowledge. The more you know, the stronger you are in any situation. Yes.
Can you talk about the role of musical director? All you guys have probably been in that situation.
Freddie, you want to go first?
The role of musical director, it's like you have a room full of people, okay? You are my orchestra, you are my band. When I walk in the room, it's like, oh, here comes Freddie, here comes Rickey. It's kind of like a respect thing. Your band and the people you work with need to respect and trust what you're going to do, what you're going to tell them, the direction you're going to go in. And you wear, as a musical director, you wear a lot of different hats. So you have to, you over here putting out this fire, then you over here doing this and that, and you're kind of all over the place, but you're here in this one place, and they can trust where you are and what you're doing. That's how I see it.
Yeah, the times that I've been asked to do that, I mean, it's been... The months leading up to the gig were the most difficult months as well. This year, I music directed the Yamaha 125th anniversary concert. It was Elton John, Toto, Mike McDonald, Earth, Wind & Fire, Chaka Khan. I mean, I'm forgetting all the people, you know, David Foster. But the month before that happened, I happened to be in Jakarta, and I spent every night on the phone all night dealing with, this drummer doesn't want to play Yamaha. Well, okay, that's a deal breaker for that band. I mean, all kinds of stuff that had nothing to do with music.
Right.
You know, and then once you do get down to the music, then you have to start figuring out, you know, what's the running order of the show, who's going to start. And this particular night, Earth, Wind had to get on a plane. So what do we start it with? Earth, Wind & Fire. I mean, you know, it's like, where do you go from there, you right. know? But we... you know, you end up being kind of having to corral everybody personally. You have to kind of be in touch with the guy that doesn't want to play those drums and he wants to bring his, and now that means you can't just go from one act to the next. You got to kind of talk to the guy and say, hey, listen, what can we work out? If we taped over the label or something like that, you know, so right. A lot of politics involved that you end up kind of corralling people. And what I like to do is try to, hey, Tal, I like to turn the each member of the band into their own, you know. Dave DeLome, he has all the tapes, and you know, give everybody a chance to kind of give input as well, you know, so that everybody feels like they're involved.
Why are you picking on a drummer?
I wasn't going to mention your name, Steve, but no.
I think for me, it's off the same thing they said. I mean, I think more so giving everyone their responsibility. Like, your job is to handle your role. Like, I won't be playing drums. I won't be playing trumpet. I won't do any of those things. So your job, if a good leader knows how to hire the right person for the job. So it's just like any football team. I'm not the running back. So in this case, I'm the quarterback. So I'm going to call the play, and this is what we're going to do. And you've got to trust that I'm going to get it in the end zone by hook or crook. So everyone, you know, everyone do your job. And if someone's not, then I lean on them just a little bit. But if I have to come to you again, you're going to be on the bench and then off the team because I don't have time. You know, the clients pay for service, and they want to sound good now, not tomorrow.
Right.
You know, and so they hire you, and they trust you with the music. And that in itself is an honor when someone calls you to trust you, like, here's my music, and please make it sound good. And so the music is one part, but it's again, the attitude. You know, everyone has to handle themselves, be on time, be prepared for the work. I mean, like you say, certain people you hire, you don't even think about that chair anymore.
Right.
You know, like if I'm conducting and I've been fortunate to have both Nathan and Freddie work with me as I'm trying to conduct and learn this thing. So once I do that, then okay, bass thing, I don't have to worry about the bass player either sound playing or anything, and they're gonna take care of business. But that's part of it, is that you want them to pull for you. You want your team. You know, anyone that doesn't like their quarterback, it's not going to be a good game.
Right.
They're not going to defend him well. You know,
the other thing that happens too is the artists have to feel comfortable with, like, their. A lot of times they won't bring their band that knows all their tunes, and they have to feel comfortable with your band.
Yeah.
And a lot of times they're kind of they're reluctant because they're saying, "Well, okay, well, I'll tell you what." And we had a thing, you know, Natalie Cole. She hadn't used the band, so I said, "Well, we'll only do 3 songs." When she got on the stage, she loved the band, so can we do 5, you know?
Right.
And it's you give them that level of comfort.
Yeah.
I saw another question there. Nick West.
Hey, Nicky.
So if you have, say you have 2 bass players, 2 guitar players that are of equal talent, what determines one getting the job versus the other?
Availability.
he said availability. I think, well, you know, I mean, that's definitely something. I think the same thing. I mean, it's what you bring to the table. What do you add? So I know the same talent, but one person is hard to get along with, the other one's always late. So I mean, you take the lesser of 2 evils, or you just say forget about both of them. They're equal talent, but neither one of them. One has a bad attitude, and the other one's always late. Can't do it.
Or what's the music, you know?
Yeah.
I thought this might be applicable to a lot of people. In the case both of Steve and Freddie and Nathan, I don't know your discography as well, but all 3 of you guys have come into gigs, you know, where you were replacing or being the new guy. Steve's case coming into the Heartbreakers after 20 years of Stan Lynch, and Freddie's case coming into Steely Dan, you know, Nathan with Eric Clapton, were all those people that had something that they were used to, whether they could articulate it or not. And how did you adapt to, this is what I do, and yes, this is this music, but it's like, I can't be your other guy that quit or was fired or you can't get anymore. How do you put enough of yourself into it to feel comfortable and also to satisfy what your boss wants?
Well, the reason why they called you, they just didn't call you. Steely Dan just didn't call me. They knew, you know, it's like I'm just trying to, they knew of my work and they knew what I was going to bring to the table. So when I came in, I knew their music. I knew the feel of their music. I knew that musical style. So I just put me into it. I didn't try to overplay it or underplay it or whatever that is. I just put my body into their music. So you can't play like the other person, because he might have played it totally different. He might have played it totally different. So if their music is a style and it's stylized in a certain way, you want to kind of stay true to it, and then you have some leeway to duck in and out. but you really want to try to stay true to the music.
Steve? Yeah, well, you know, so I did a gig with a band in Italy called The Poop, and they've been together for over 30 years, and I did it. It caused a big, over there, it was big news, you know, and they, a guy asked me, he said, what, you know, do you realize the huge job that you've got in front of you, you know? And I said, well, I replaced Bobby McIntosh in The Average White Man. Phil Collins in playing with Eric. I played in Duran Duran for crying out loud. and currently I play with Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers, and so I replaced Andrew. And I think that, you know, the body of work that all these guys, the bands that I've gone into, the body of work the guys that I've replaced has been really valid. They've all done something valid, and they've all done something that you have to stay faithful to. Some stuff that you just can't play anything else.
Right.
You know? I think you do that, and then you own the rest of the seat yourself. You're gonna make some stuff yourself that people that they're gonna miss if you're not playing. You know?
Yeah.
So
that's about it. So. Thanks. Yeah. Now, pretty much, everything you said. And basically what you, I've seen some guys come in and have to do some, you know, fill in. I know with Foreplay, we started with Lee Ritenour on guitar. Then we got Larry Carlton, two of the baddest guys around. And then so Chuck Loeb came in, and he's the new guy. But I know from a band standpoint, we didn't expect him to be Lee or Larry. And what he brought was so much of his own thing, and it was so great. And he puts his thing. So I think... what most people want when they call you is they want your fingerprint, you know, attached to their situation.
Yeah, and for me, I actually have followed these guys on gigs, and it's not that much fun. Yeah.
No, Rickey, I can go back. 1986, I was Nathan was with Al Jarreau. I came after Nathan, and then when I got ready to leave, I said, Rickey, come with me. Sit here. This is your gig. So he sat there, and he played the stew out of that gig. And from there, on wherever else he went, that's what he was doing. So he was in it.
And I was terrified.
The study.
but what after the first night, and I guess, you know, I mean, because people know, like, if you're nervous, like, people know, like, if you're, you know. They can feel you. And I guess Al must have felt me that night, and he said, hey, man, don't worry about what Freddie played, man. You're here because of you, so play you. That's what I want. I want to hear you do your thing. And then we ended up expanding, doing some stuff that I, you know, he kind of saw me practicing, like, a lot of jazz standard stuff and, you know, at doing sound check, and he's like, hey, man, you know that thing you did one night? He just said, hey, that thing you were doing at sound check today, here, come up here, let's do that. And then it ended up being like a whole 15-minute thing of, I just learned a lot of songs that I knew he knew, old jazz standard stuff he did with George Duke when it was just the two of them,
right.
And study, but same thing, just study the stuff Nathan do, and then just, you know, make it feel good. I mean, you'll find your own way, but make it feel good. And of course, the first night that I played, though, because I love Freddie's playing so much that I went and bought me a Ken Smith bass just like Freddie's. But I premiered it on the first gig. I even left my four string at home because I was going to force myself to play five string. And of course, the opening night, I couldn't figure out what string was what. And who happened to be in the audience in Europe? Toto. My first time playing... And meeting Jeff Beccaro, and I don't even know, I might have played one good note. One might have slipped out of me, but I was so embarrassed. I didn't even want to meet those cats. And then the same thing with Nathan. Nathan, when he got me to get with Gladys, he was flying, taking flying lessons. And so I was at the sessions every day sitting with him. And then the flying lessons were at night, so he would do the sessions during the day. And they said, well, who should we get at night? So, well, Rickey been here every day. I mean, let Rickey play. I mean, he can read, he can play, and he's, you know, put me on. So he had this Roland synth bass thing. It had a module stuff, and so I got all my money, and I ran out and got me a synth bass. the Roland synth bass, and learn how to, and I would sit there and watch how he programmed it. So, you know, so there's nothing wrong with learning and following people, because you can't learn everything on your own. You don't have the time in life to make all the mistakes there is to make. So, you know, try to learn from people around you that you respect, yep, and study and work hard. The job doesn't always go to the most talented, it goes to the one who works the hardest.
Yeah, absolutely.
And people with talent sometimes take that for granted, and they're not willing to work hard.
Right.
So work harder. Outwork the guy next to you.
Yeah, all right.
Thank you, guys. Thank you so much. Thank you, Chris. Thanks, Steve. Nate.
Thanks, Ricky.
Keep ready.
All right, you guys.